गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, देर आर 9 स्टूडेंट्स, सो विल स्टार्ट द सेशन, फर्स्ट सेशन. सो मोस्टली दिस पर्टिकुलर कोर्स विल बी हैंड्स ऑन. ओके, सो यू कैन पैरेलली प्रैक्टिस. आई विल ऑल्सो गिव सम टाइम टू practice. Okay, some of the task, simple task I will ask you to do. I will give timings. Okay, so shall we start?
Yes sir.
Yeah, and the other thing, I don't want to give more introduction about the story behind Python. Just I will introduce what is what. This is the person, Gudo Van Rossum. This is the person who introduced Python. It is actually released in 1990s. Okay. Very important thing. Why we need to go for Python? There are so many programming languages available. Why we need to go for Python? Because one important reason is it has very powerful programming features. If you go for deep learning, machine learning, data science, okay, big data analysis, in all those things, okay, there are very powerful libraries are developed, okay, in Python. That is the biggest advantage, and it can work in different OS versions, Windows, Mac, Linux, okay, etc. Then another advantage is if you compare Python with other programming languages, if you just see the syntax, it will be very simple. Okay, like English language, the syntax will be very simple, like English language, normal English language. So you, anyone can easily learn, anyone can easily practice. Okay, that is another advantage, so you don't want to write, okay, very big code. With fewer lines you can complete the task. Okay, that is another advantage. So syntax are very powerful, so that the given task can be completed within fewer lines when compared to other programming languages. Then again, you know what is interpreter and what is a compiler. So MATLAB, Python, they use actually interpreter, whereas C language, it uses compiler. So in compiler, if you see, it will first run the it will first execute the entire code. It will check entire code. It will generate an intermediate object file. Then if there are errors, you have to rectify the whole code. Okay, then only after compiling, okay, once your code is error free, then only you can run. Whereas in Python and MATLAB, it's completely different. It works in interpreter, so each and every line is executed. Okay, say you have error in the fourth line, it will just point out that fourth line error. If you rectify it, say there is another error in 10th line, then it will say error in the 10th line, then it will say error in 15th line. So like that it will go. Whereas in C language, it will say all the errors together. Okay, this is one advantage. And you can use this Python for object oriented programming. Already very big organizations like YouTube, Google, Yahoo, NASA, they are using Pythons. Among all these advantages, very important thing is it's freely available, it's open source. Okay, no need to pay. That is very important. If you want to use MATLAB, then you have to purchase the license. Okay, you have to pay for it. If you are using, say for example, if you are using communication toolbox, for that separately you have to pay. If you are using some machine learning or deep learning toolbox, then you have to pay. Okay, whereas here, that's not required. It's freely available. Okay. So with this introduction, we'll directly go for programming. I don't want to discuss much about Python. Whether my spider screen is visible? Students?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, once you install Spider, you will get something like this. Maybe the background, all those things may differ. Okay. So I just set the appearance something like MATLAB. If you go for view, here you can find out that option. You can see Windows layout, MATLAB layout kind of thing. So earlier I used to work in MATLAB, so I was much comfortable in that appearance. So I am just using this appearance, and you may have by default that dark background. Those things you can just check it in this tools and view. You can change it whatever you want. So I am just preferring this particular appearance. There are two things here. Right side, if you notice, it is basically IPython console. IPython is interactive Python console. Okay. This is something like, or it is equivalent to command window in MATLAB. Okay. By this time, you may be familiar in MATLAB. This is equivalent to command window in MATLAB. Whereas there is other thing here. Okay, this is actually editor window. It's something like editor window in MATLAB. So here you can practice some commands. You can do some simple arithmetic operations. Even you can write your program. Everything you can do it in the console itself. But the problem is, once you close your spider, whatever you have typed here, those things will go. Whereas if you do programming in this editor window, if you do programming in the editor window, you can save it. By default, Python files will be stored with .py format, .py format. You can notice already I have stored some of the programs here. Okay, I have stored some of the programs here. So whenever you want, you can open the program, you can update the program, you can delete some part. Okay, so those things are possible. Okay, so whatever you are working here, whatever you are saving, that will be there always. Okay, whereas if you write some code in the console, that will go. It's same, it's almost similar to the command window and editor window in MATLAB. Okay, and another difference is, in MATLAB you have to save the file first. Okay, you have to save the file, then only you can execute. Whereas, for example, let me take this particular code, piece of code in Python. Okay, I don't want this. I don't want anything. I'm just deleting. You just see, I'm not saving this. I'm just running. Okay, it is executed. It's not necessary to save the program. Okay, then also you can execute your code. These are some of the features, and there are many platforms for this Python. You can use the Python original version itself. I'm just using this Spider IDE. There are many more IDEs available. Okay, even Jupyter Notebook, it's something like browser. Okay, you can, the appearance will be something like browser. Whatever, there are many things available. I'm just preferring this Spider. I am more convenient with this Spider because of the appearance, like MATLAB, and so many advantages are available. While writing the code, I will tell the other advantages one by one. Okay, so first we'll just start. Okay. With variables, I think some of the students may be already familiar with the basics. Okay, so it is it's something like a refresher one for those students. So for other students, okay, this may be a eye opener. So let me start. Okay. I'm just defining some variable name x. X is equal to 10. Okay, x is equal to 10. Otherwise, I'll just practice here. That's it. If you go for C language, if you are familiar in C, you need to define what is the data type of this x, whether it is an integer, int x, int y, something like that you have to do. Then only you have to use that variable for assigning some values and all. In Python, no need of defining the data type. Okay, no need of defining the data type. Once you assign the value to the variable, automatically the corresponding data type will be assigned. Once you assign the value to the variable, automatically, okay, the data type is assigned. If you want to see the data type, okay, if you want to see the data type, type the corresponding variable name. So you can notice, okay, this x is an integer. Okay, so I didn't initialize x as integer. Based on the value, automatically the data type is assigned. Okay, another request, students, if you don't understand, if you don't follow, please raise your hand symbol, or you can unmute your mic and you can raise your questions. Okay, your understanding, that is more important than covering more topics. Okay, I hope that these are basics, so I'm just going a little bit fast. Okay, if you don't understand or you need some time to practice, please raise your hand so that I can wait for some time. Okay, similarly, y is equal to 12.4. Okay, y is equal to 12.4. So if you see the type of y, by default it is float. Okay, it is float. So in Python, if you see, they talk about three major numerals. One is integer type, another one is float type, third type of numerals is complex. You know that a complex number will have a real part and imaginary part. Okay, a complex number will have a real part and imaginary part. For example, if I want to define 2 + 3j, that's it. Okay, 2 real part, 3 imaginary part, j is that square root of minus 1. If you just see the type of z, that is complex. Okay, if you see the type of z, that is complex. So these are three different numerals, okay, data types corresponding to the numbers. Okay, in the same way you can write strings also. For example, let me take some student's name, Gajapati. Okay, so if you want to define a string, you need to understand that you need to use double quotes. That's very important. Okay, you have to define the string within double quotes. Even you can define the string within single quotes. Whatever convenient for you, you can use it, either single quotes or double quotes. Okay, maybe the same name. Okay, A is equal to, otherwise I will go for some other name. Amarnath. Okay, see, it's not showing any error. Okay, it's not showing any error. So the value is assigned to the variable. The value is assigned to the variable. If you see the type, of s, so it is basically a string. Okay, s is basically a string. Similarly, if you see the type of a, that is also a string. Okay, that is also a string. Suppose if I define like this, so if you want to see the previous commands, you can press the up arrow. Okay, you can press the up arrow. Suppose I am not using either single quotes or double quotes. If I assign like this, you can notice it is displaying some error, name error. That means that's not defined. Okay, it is not accepting. It's showing some error. Okay, so you remember that if it is string type, you need to define within single quotes or double quotes. Okay, so we discussed very important data types: integer, float, complex, then string. Then there are many things like list, set, tuples, all those things. So those things in the third session I will discuss. I don't want to introduce those things here. Okay, so now if you see, I have used different variables: x, y, z, s, a, all those things. Okay, so technically these variables are also called as identifiers. Okay, they are also called as identifiers. Yeah, so how do you define identifiers in Python? How do you define identifiers in Python? Okay, identifiers are nothing but, okay, they are the variable names. So there are some rules. Okay, there are some rules to define identifier. So far I have used a single character to define the identifier. You can go for any number of characters. Say for example, this Gajapati itself, instead of yes, I might have defined like this. Now the identifier name is, okay, name. So if you just see the name, you can notice the Gajapati. Gajapati is assigned to the identifier name. Okay, this is also a string. So there is no restriction in the number of characters or the number of characters present in the identifier. Okay, even I can use the mix of small letters and capital letters. See, the identifiers are case sensitive. Okay, the identifiers are case sensitive. This name is different from whatever the name I have defined in 14. Okay, whatever the name I have defined here, this and this, they are different. Suppose if I type name, it will type Gajapati. If I type this name, it will type Vinod. So this identifiers, they are case sensitive. Even one letter, first letter is capital N, rest all other letters are small. It's just different variables. They are different variables. Okay, I can also use mix of, okay, capital letter, small letter and numbers. Okay, see, this is also allowed. You can use mix of capital letters, small letters. You can also use special characters. Want to see what is the value here? Okay. Okay, I think just a minute. We should not use star. See, underscore is allowed. I'm sorry. Star is not allowed. only underscore is allowed. I'm sorry here. A small confusion. Underscore, that's the special character that is allowed. Okay, underscore is allowed. Let me try. Instead of this underscore, if I go for some other special character like hash, you just see it will show some error. Okay, it does some other operation. Actually, I expected that it has to show just 100, but it has given some other operation. So this is not the valid variable assignment. Okay, this is not the valid variable assignment. Please make a note of it. Only underscore, that's the special character allowed. Even in between, you can use the underscore name. Okay. So these are various things. It can be completely small letter, completely capital letter, or mix of capital letter, small letter. Then you can use underscore, special character underscore. Okay. Even I think this is correct assignment. It can start with underscore also. Okay, it can start, the variable name can start with underscore. Okay, so these are whatever I have written, I have explained so far, these are valid identifiers. Okay, these are valid identifiers. So if I say valid identifiers, then there is something called invalid identifiers. Okay, invalid identifiers. So what are the invalid identifiers that we will discuss now? Okay, suppose if I leave some space, I should not use space. I should not use space in the variable name. Okay, I should not use space, but space, that is a valid identifier. I should not use space. Another thing, I already said, other than underscore, you should not use any special character. That is the second rule. Other than underscore, you should not use any special character. Then the third one, the variable name should not start with numbers. In between you can have, even the second character can be the number, or at the end you can have, but the variable name should not start with numbers. Okay, the variable name should not start with numbers. Okay, let me check any other rules are there. So, okay. So then in Python, there is something called keywords. Okay. So identifiers are the names. Okay. We are using for the variables. Whereas keywords are some of the names. Okay. That is already used in Python. So we are not allowed to use. Okay. We are not allowed to use the keywords as the variable name. We are not allowed to use keywords as the variable name. For example, and it's a keyword. You can notice once I type, automatically the color is getting, okay. You can notice for identifiers, it's black color. The values, it is red color. Here it's blue color. So the colors are changing. Okay. Suppose if I give and is equal to 1000, you can notice some error, syntax error, because and is the keyword. Okay, and is the keyword. There are many keywords available in the Python. Okay, there are many keywords available in the Python. We should not use those keywords as the variable name. Okay, let me display a slide. So where you can notice different keywords okay, this is not the only keyword, there are many more, something like and, delete, not, as, elif, if, else, import, okay, true, continue, break, okay, while, define, these are the keywords, okay, these are the keywords in Python. So the variable name, a keyword, okay, that is very important. Okay, then okay, see, then in MATLAB, can anyone say what is the symbol we will use to represent a comment line? Any idea? How do you represent comment line in MATLAB? So if you know the answer, you can unmute and you can say. Okay, in MATLAB we use percentage, that's the comment line. So in the same way, in Python, the comment line is this hash symbol. If you are using hash symbol, that particular line will not be considered for during the compilation or during the execution, that particular line will not be considered. Say for example, I'm just writing a code, okay, I'm just writing a code, let me use some code, okay. So this is the code I want to execute, okay. I'm just, okay, saying something here. Say for example, just for my reference, I'm just saying this is initialization, okay, initialization. Say here I'm writing, it is increment, okay, increment. Say this is something like this is actually for printing, okay. So these are just for my reference. If I execute, see, without any error it is giving some output, but without this, if I use it, will definitely show the error. So whatever I have, I'm just writing after that hash symbol, they are actually the comment lines. Even before the program, you can write, okay, this program is basically printing a pattern, okay, printing a pattern using while loop, okay. So this is for my reference, okay. Suppose there are many lines, there are many lines, okay, those things actually needs to be used as comment lines. So every time I cannot use, okay, this hash symbol. Say there are some 10 lines, okay, I just want to mention that this code is developed by Vinod Babu, okay. I'm just writing some description about this program, and I'm just writing my affiliation, all those things. So every time I cannot write, I cannot include this hash. Just to avoid, what I can do, I can go for a multi-line, okay, comment line. What it means, just add triple quotes, just end triple quotes, okay, whatever you don't want, okay, whatever you want as comment lines, okay, you just start, before that you start with three quotes, you just end, okay, with these three quotes, okay. So you can see automatically the color is changing. Now if you execute, see, without any error your code is working. So this is actually multi-line comments, okay, using triple quotes, okay. If it is single line, single line, if you want to use as a comment line, then you can use hash symbol. If it is for multiple lines, you can go for triple quotes. Okay, is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Am I going in proper speed, or you want me to go a little bit slow?
I think we are okay, sir.
Is okay?
Fine, sir. It's good.
Okay. 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 See, now what I'm going to do. So in C language, in other programming languages, already I told you have to define the data type, then only you have to define the variable. Okay, say for example, I'm just using MATLAB or some other programming language. Say A is equal to 100, next line B is equal to 1000, C is equal to 2000, so D is equal to 5000, something like this. Okay, so here it's very simple. Okay, this is actually called assigning values to multiple variables. You can do it, okay, in one line. So you just define all the variables, okay, in the left hand side, A comma B comma C comma D, is equal to right hand side, all the corresponding values. You should not change the order. That is very important. Okay. 100, 1000, 2000, 5000. Just hit a enter. That's it. Automatically the values are stored. Okay. If I type A, you can see 100, B, 1000, C, 2000, D, 5000. It's not necessarily integer. It can be any. It can be any data type. Say for example, D. I want to assign a complex number for D. For C, I want to define a string. For B, I want to define a float. So everything is possible. You just see now, A is 100, B is the float value, C is a string, D is a complex number. So this is actually called assigning values to multiple variables. Assigning values to multiple variables. Okay. Similarly, some of you might have attended this interviews. Okay. So most of the companies, they will ask if you have two numbers, if you have two variables, they will ask how do you swap the values? How do you swap the values in the variables without using the third variable? So usually, when people are teaching, they will go for a dummy variable. They use the swap concept. Okay, then without using the third variable, how do you swap? There are many methodologies available. So all those things are not required here. Say for example, A is 100. Okay, I'm just doing A is equal to 100, B is equal to 200. Okay, so if I want to do swapping, A comma B is equal to B comma A. So if you see A value, it has become 200. If you see B value, it has become 100. So swapping, assignment of values, they are very easy in Python. Okay, so no need of third variable. Similarly, say I'm just going to discuss sharing between variables. Okay. Say for example, I have a string. Okay, I have a string. Say hi. Okay, I just want to share this between A and B. You just see automatically they are assigned. H is assigned to A, I is assigned to B. It's very simple. Suppose if it is something like this, you can see that automatic assignment that is showing some error because there are only two variables, but four characters are available in the right side. Okay, so it says that too many values to unpack. Okay, you expected only two values, but more than two values are available, so it is showing an error. So what I'm doing now, I'm just adding a star before A, just hit enter. Now it is not showing any error. Okay, now it is not showing any error. Type A and hit enter. Okay, so B is assigned to A. See B, all the remaining characters, they are stored in B. Okay, but there are more than one character available. So what is happening? Those characters are stored in a list format. Okay. If you notice something with square bracket opened and closed, it is actually a list in Python, list or array. Okay, this we are going to discuss in the third session. So you can notice all the remaining characters A, B, U, they are stored in B, okay, in a list format. Okay, it's sequence, more than one character we have, it's a sequence. So the sequence is stored in a list format. List is one of the sequence. Okay, set, list, tuple, dictionary, these are the sequences. Suppose of adding star to B, add to A, any guess what could be the output? Any guess?
For A, the output is BAB, and for B, the output is U.
Very good. So A, okay, all the characters except what is assigned to B. Okay, one-to-one matching. For B, it is U. Okay, all the remaining characters, BAB, okay, they are assigned to A. Okay, whenever something is anonymous in Python, they use this star. Okay, in the last session, we are going to discuss about the lambda function. So there we'll discuss much about this star. See the next one. Casting in Python. Okay. Casting in Python. Casting in the sense, we are going to convert one data type to another data type. Okay. One data type to another data type. Okay. This is actually casting. Okay. For example, I have a float number. I want to convert this to an integer. I'm just using a int constructor. Okay, int constructor. You just see now the 12.8 has become 12. So 12 is an integer. So earlier, if you notice what is the data type of B, that is float. Whereas if you see the data type of A, it is an integer. Similarly, you can also convert this 12.8 float to string. The constructor is str. You just see automatically a single quotes, okay, that is added. We know that either single quote or double quote, that is basically string. If you are still not convinced, you can go for type of C. It is string in nature. Okay, it is string. For example, I have some C is equal to 100, D is equal to minus 80. Okay, now C plus D. Can you guess what could be the output? Any guess?
Error.
Okay, error is one answer. So do not bother about your answer. It is wrong also, no issue. Everyone will make mistake. Before some 4 or 5 months back, if you ask, I'm actually zero here. Now at least I could handle some course. Okay, so don't bother about the errors and all mistakes. Okay, so whatever you know, whatever coming to your mind, you can give.
Sir, under double quotes, 100 minus 80.
Under double quotes?
100 minus 80.
Okay. See, this plus operator, again, I will highlight in strings. This plus is actually, okay, this plus actually is string concatenation. This plus is, if both variables are string, then it will do concatenation. Okay, this will do concatenation. So 100 and minus 80, they are concatenated. They are in string format. They are concatenated and it is giving 100 minus 80. You want the arithmetic operation. If you want the arithmetic operation, then obviously what you have to do, you have to do this int C plus int D. Okay, you have to do int C plus int D. In the same way, say I have an integer 10. I want to convert this integer to float. The constructor here I'm using is float. You can notice if I type A, it is just 10. Whereas if I type B, it is 10.0. Okay, 10.0. So the type of A is integer, whereas the type of B is float, floating point number. Even this A, I can convert to a complex number. You can see actually it is only 10, but it is represented in complex format because there is no imaginary part. So 10 plus J0. if you see the data type of C, it is complex. Okay. Here the important thing is, say already I have a complex number 1 plus 2j. If I want to convert that to integer, okay, if I want to convert that this complex number to integer, it will show error. Okay, you cannot convert a complex data type to other data type. Okay, that is the restriction. But other data types, okay, you can convert into complex. Okay, so this is I just introduced what is costing. Okay, converting one data type to another data type. Okay, so now we'll discuss a very important thing, operators in Python. Okay, operators in Python. Can I start our unit sometime? Are you comfortable up to now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So first we'll discuss arithmetic operators. Okay, we'll discuss arithmetic operators. So otherwise, I'll do here in the console. I have a is equal to 100, b is equal to, in one line you can do a comma b is equal to 100 comma whatever the number you want to give, you can do it. Okay, first one, addition, plus is used to add, plus for addition, minus for subtraction, star for multiplication, and for modulus operation, okay, for division, first I will complete division. You just see 100 by 50, it is 2. So slash for division, plus minus star slash. Okay, then if you want remainder, this actually gives the quotient. If you want the remainder, you just see it is zero. Let me take some other number, 7c, d is equal to 7, 2. You can understand that modulus clearly. If you divide 7 by 2, the remainder is 1. So this percentage is for modulus. Okay, in MATLAB for exponents, for exponent you will be using this cap. Suppose I want to write a is equal to 100 power 3. Okay, I want to write 100 power 3, so a star star 3, okay, that will give this number. So this is actually a cube. So for exponent, you need to use double star. Okay. So here you can notice A is 100, B is 50. When I do A by B, it is 2. Otherwise, I'll take the C and D. C divided by D, it is 3.5. If I do this double slash and D, you can notice the value is 3. This operator is basically called floor division. So what it will do, first it will divide. So after dividing, I will get 3.5. So you know floor is a type of rounding up operation. Even it is 3.99, that will be rounded to the lowest integer. Okay, so it is rounding to 3. So whatever we have discussed so far, these are the arithmetic operators. Okay, these are important arithmetic operators. So more frequently we will use. Okay, this floor division may be new for you. Even this double star, okay, that may be new. Other things are similar to MATLAB, plus minus, star division, all those things are similar. This percentage in MATLAB they use for comment line, so this percentage will not work in MATLAB. Okay. Shall I go for the next one?
Yes, sir.
See, the next one is comparison operators. Okay, comparison operators. See, I have two variables. So these comparison operators, the output is basically Boolean in nature. Boolean in the sense it will just return true or false. Okay. So first one, first comparison operator, I'm just checking whether A and B are equal. So they are not equal, so it is returning false. Okay, if I go some other number C, so if I do this, A double equal to C, you can notice it's true. So this comparison operators, it is Boolean in nature, so always it will return true or false only. So double equal to, okay, single equal to is for assignment, double equal to for comparison. Next one, I'm checking whether A is greater than B. It's true because A is 100, B is 50, so the condition is true. If I do the reverse, it's false. So greater than. So greater than is the second comparison operator. Then less than, so A is 100, B is 50, so it's false. But if I write the reverse one, it's true. Greater than, less than, another one, A greater than or equal to C, it's true. Okay, A less than or equal to B, it's false. Okay, double equal to, greater than, less than, greater than or equal to, less than or equal to, yeah, one more thing, not equal to. Okay, A for not equal to, near that tab, above the tab, you can notice the symbol. A not equal to B. Okay, A is 100, B is equal to 50. They are not equal, so it will return true. Suppose if I do this, A not equal to C, it is false because A and C, they have the same value. So it is false. Shall I start the next one?
Yes, sir.
So next one is logical operators. So what are the logical operators available? And or not. So earlier I while explaining identifiers, I used and. I said and is the keyword, so we should not use and for assigning using as variable. So what is the use of this and? Okay, it's something like in digital electronics you might have studied the truth table. So when both the conditions, okay, whatever the condition in the right hand side and left hand side, when both are true, then only this will be true. For example, we know A value is 100, B value is 50, C value is 100. Okay, so let us create something like this. A greater than B and A less than C. So what is this? A greater than B, is it true or false?
True.
What about this condition? A less than C?
False.
False. So one condition is true, another condition is false, so it is false. Suppose if I change like this, this is also true, this is also true, this and will return true. Okay, logical and. Suppose the same condition, whatever I have discussed here, same condition, instead of and, if I use or, so it's something like or gate, okay, at least one input is true, it is true. So this is true, this is false, okay, so it has to return true. Suppose if I change the condition something like this, double equal to, then both are false, then it will return false. Okay, so not is nothing but, you know, this is actually false. I'm just adding a bracket before this. I'm adding not to this. So earlier it is false, now it is true. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Are you practicing parallelly, students?
Yes, sir.
See, I need response from others also.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'll just go for the next operator, identity operator. Okay, identity operator. So what are the identity operators available in Python? It's is not. Okay, is and is not. Let me define a list. Okay, let me define a list. So there are some entries, 100, 200, 300. Another list, 100, 200, 300. Okay. Now I'm just checking whether X and Y are identical. What is the answer you are expecting?
True.
Yeah. So basically, again, this identity operator is Boolean. It will return either true or false. Okay. So what is the answer you are expecting? So can you justify why it is true? The items are same. Am I right? So you are telling this is true. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
The items are same, 100, 200, 300. So let me check this. So it is showing false. Let me do another one. Z is equal to X. So this is actually assignment. Okay. This is actually assignment operation. Now I am checking whether Z is Y. Sorry. Z is X because X is assigned to Z. See, earlier it was false, now it is true. So you just understand this identity operator, it works based on the memory, not based on the items what is present in the this X and Y. So if you want to see the memory location where this X is stored, you can use ID of X. So this is some memory. If you see the memory of Y, you can notice this and this, they are different. Even though the items are same, they are different. So that is the reason Python is telling that these are not identical. These are not identical. Whereas if you see the ID of Z, you can notice, okay, X ID and Z ID, they are same. So whenever you are using this assignment operator, okay, directly it is pointing to that memory, that's it. But you can show that X is not Y, that is actually true. Because X and Y, they are not identical. It's true. So it is based on the memory. Okay, is it clear, students?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Next one is membership operators. Okay, membership operators. In Python, there are two membership operators, in, not in. Okay, in, not in. Let me take a list. Okay, I'll take a list here. Say I have an integer, I have a floating point number, I have a complex number. I'm just taking some what is that, a float, okay, something like this. I want to check whether an item is a member of this list. I want to check whether an item is a member of this list. For example, 10 in X. Again, this is Boolean. It is going to return true or false. I'm just checking whether 10 is in the list X. It is true. 10.2 in X, it's true. In X, it's true. Suppose if I use this, it's false because we know that it's case sensitive. okay? But if I use not in, so this VAT in small letters, that is not there in the list, so it will return true. Membership operator. Okay, have you completed? Can I continue?
Yes, sir.
Next one, bitwise operations. Okay, bitwise operations. So before going for bitwise operation, if you have a decimal number, you want to convert into binary, it's very easy. You can use bin. Okay, say for example, I want to see what is the binary equivalent of 10. So this 0B represents it is in binary format. Okay, for 10, it is 1010. Suppose if you want to convert this to an octal number, okay, so 0O represents it's a octal number. Similarly, if you want to convert this to an hexadecimal number, you can use X. So 0X represents it's an hexadecimal number. So if you want to convert this hexadecimal number or this octal number or this binary number back to decimal, it's very, very simple. Just type 0XA, that's it. It is giving that decimal equivalent, 0, octal O 12, you type it is 10. 0B 1010, you type it's giving 10. Okay. So we are going for bitwise operations. Okay, I will just show my presentation. Can you see this window, new window?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. See, the first bitwise operation is AND operation. Okay, so I'm going to use this ampersand symbol for AND operation. 1 minute. Okay, so say X is 10, Y is 4. If I want to do bitwise AND, I need to do something like this. X, first you have to define. In Python, you can parallelly try x comma y is equal to 10 comma 4. So this 10 will be automatically assigned to x. This 4 will be automatically assigned to y. So you can do x ampersand y. You can notice that will give result 0. The reason is the binary equivalent of 10 is 1010. The binary equivalent of 4 is 0100. So you do AND operation, 00, it's 0, 100, 01, it's 0, 100, others are 0. So this is equivalent to 0, decimal number 0. So are you getting 0? See, you cannot see these intermediate things. Okay, these values and all you cannot see, just for understanding how the function works, how the operator works, I'm just explaining what is happening. So if you just do x and y, directly it will give zero. So for bitwise or, you can use this pipe symbol. So above the, in the keyboard, above enter key, you can notice this pipe symbol. So for the same numbers, if you do x pipe y, you will get answer 14. The reason is you just do OR operation. At least one input is one, it will give one. So this is zero, here it is one, here it is one, here it is one. So the decimal equivalent for this 0110 is 14. Are you getting 14? Are you getting 14?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then for XOR operation, this cap or hat, okay, cap symbol or hat symbol, you know, XOR, when two inputs are same, then it is zero. When they are different, it is one. Same thing, I'm just taking same x and y. If you do this x hat y, you can notice you will get 14. Okay, so 0, 0, same. So it's 0, 1, 0, it is 1, 0, 1, it is 1, 1, 0, it is 1. So again, you will get 14 if you do XOR operation. Are you getting 14?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then for NOT operation, you can use this tilde symbol. Again, above, what is the tab, you can notice this tilde. If you do this tilde of x, it will give the result. Actually, it will give the 2's complement result. Okay. So tilde is for NOT. You can try, if you just take x and if you try, you can notice minus 11 as the answer, but it's 2's complement. You just study, I think you may be knowing what is 2's complement, okay? I am not going to explain that. The other two binary operators, this greater than symbol 2 times. So you can easily remember the direction, okay? It's something like an arrow direction, wherever it is pointing. This is pointing right side. So you can remember that this is bitwise right shift. Suppose if I am using less than 2 times, this is bitwise left shift. Okay, bitwise right shift, bitwise left shift. So I have x is equal to 10. I'm just doing this operation x greater than 2. So how it works means the binary equivalent of x is 40. I'm just using 8-bit representation. 1010 is 10. So 2 bits, okay, that is shifted to right. So this 10 that will come out of the window. This will come out of the window. Additional zeros will come here. So what the corresponding binary equivalent is to, always you remember, whenever you do right shift, okay, you will lose some bits. Whereas if you do the left shift for the same thing, x less than 2, so this is the binary equivalent of 10, okay? So these two zeros that will come out, these two zeros here, 10, 10, additionally 2 zeros. If you see the binary equivalent, I think that is 40. Are you getting this 2 and 40 for left shift and right shift?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So these are bitwise operators. Finally, assignment operators. Okay, finally, assignment operators. Say x is equal to 10. I want to update this x. Okay, I want to add 2 to this x, and I want to store that the result. Okay, the result in x itself. So usually what we'll do like this, x is equal to x plus 2. So in Python, it's very easy. You can combine this arithmetic operation and assignment operation together, x. Okay, otherwise what I will do, I will again define x. Okay, x plus is equal to 2. You can notice it is doing the required operation. So arithmetic assignment operations together. Okay, arithmetic and assignment operations together. You can do this. Suppose from this x, okay, I want to subtract 2. This is actually nothing but x is equal to x minus 2. This is equivalent to x is equal to x minus 2. You just notice in the same way you can do multiplication, all arithmetic operations you can do. Okay, even bitwise operations also you can do. For example, I want to multiply x by 2, and that result I want to store it in x itself. You just see x is 20 now. Is it clear, students, participants?
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, now in C language for input, I think same input is there, and for output you can use a print. Here also you have that input and print methods. Okay. This is actually used to define, used to get the input from the user through the keyboard. Okay, x, enter the input. Okay, whatever you are giving within double quotes, that statement will come. Okay, otherwise I will type this here. X, y is equal to input, enter, say enter the input 1, enter the input 2. Okay, see, my intention is I want to add this x and y. Let me execute the code. And just see, whatever the statement I have given here, the same statement is coming here. So the user, every time you are executing the code, the user can give the desired input. So that is input method. If you see Python 2.7, they have raw input, but now they have modified that to input. Okay, the recent versions will work only with this input method, input command. Second input, let me give 800. So any guess, I entered everything. So I want to see what is Z. Any guess, what could be the Z value?
900, sir.
Okay, Surya Teja said it's 900. Any other guess? 900 is one answer.
Sir, 100800, sir.
Okay, Vamsi Krishna said 100800. So let me display and check. See, you have expected 100 plus 800, it is 900, but it is giving 100, 800 as it is, and it is displayed within single quotes. So you need to understand that the answer is displayed in string format. Always you remember, whenever you use input method, the default data type is string. Okay, the default data type is string. So if you want integers, okay, so we know the int operator. Okay, int constructor, it's not an operator, it's int constructor. And I'm just adding int constructor before that. Now if I execute, you can see the answer. Okay, it's not necessarily integer, you can have float also. Okay, whatever you want, you can do float. Hundred, 800. If you print Z, it is 900.0. So instead of every time typing Z here, I want to display the output. Okay, so print, okay, some statement, something like this, the added output. The added output is comma Z. So whatever the statement I am giving here, that followed by Z will come. 100, 800. See, the same statement is getting printed. Is it clear, students?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so for input, user defined input, input method. By default, data type is string. Just to print the statements, okay, whatever you want to display in the output, you can use a print method. Now you just see, I'm giving some floating point number. This is the first input. This is the second input. You just see automatically some output I'm getting. So this is not looking in proper format. Okay, this is not looking in proper format. Say I just want only 5, 9. I don't want all other things. Okay, if that is the case, you just see what is the modification I'm doing. Int, okay, added output, same statement. Let me give the added output is, I'm just adding curly braces. This is actually called placeholder. Okay, otherwise let me enhance this output. The addition of, okay, okay, See, I want to display my first number here, second number here, and the addition here. Okay. So all the statements you just give, wherever you want the output, you add the proper placeholders. Then you just use format. Okay, this is actually called string formatting. You just use format. Then within bracket, you supply the inputs x, y, z. Okay, x, y, z. Automatically, x will go for the first placeholder, y will go for the second placeholder, z will go for the third placeholder. You just see, I'm just executing, I'm just giving the numbers 10.24455, same number. Let me give 12 point. Okay, any other thing? Can you see the output? This is the output from the previous print in line number 27, whereas here you just see the addition of 10.24456 and 12.345668 is okay. You just see there are more after dot. Okay, there are many numbers coming. Even I don't want this. So what I can do, I'm just using within the placeholder, I'm just using a colon dot 2f. Okay, I'll say what is that. Okay, let me execute. Let me repeat the same thing. Okay, any number. Can you see the difference? See, now the output is 10 plus 12, it is 22. Okay, here actually you can notice the format. What I mentioned earlier, it is floating point number. Earlier the output was floating point number. Now I just converted that to fixed point number. So okay, it says that after dot there will be only two numbers. After dot there will be two decimals. Okay, suppose if I give 3, you can see the difference. Now it is printing 3. Okay, this is actually string formatting. This format method is called string formatting. So you can display the output. Okay, you can present the output in a neat way. Okay, with this, I'm just completing first session. If you have any doubts, you can raise. So these are the topics I wanted to cover in this first 1.5 hours. Almost I covered it. In case if you have any doubts, you can raise your doubts.
Hello, sir.
Vishnu, tell Vishnu.
Sir, we can add that plus operator in the print statement, right? Instead of that bracket, can we add that? We can add, I think.
Plus statement in the sense concatenation.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can do what is telling something like is it you want to say, Vishnu? This is what you want to say.
Yes, sir.
See, actually, this is string concatenation. So first x is coming. This is actually a string with space. Just space is present. So you can notice between Vinod and Babu that space is coming. If you don't use that without space, okay, two strings are concatenated.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this also you can prefer to print the required information. What about first session? Is it good, students? Maybe if you know Python already, this may be this is just the revision. If you don't know Python, these are very important information. Actually, whatever I am teaching today, that is one full semester course for first year BTech students. Okay, so almost 45 lab hours we are taking to cover this thing, but I'm just telling what is what. Okay, because in one day, in 5 hours or 6 hours, we cannot complete the entire thing. Okay, I'll stop here. Again at 11:30 we'll start. Okay, thank you, students. Thank you, participants. There are some faculty members available. Thank you, participants.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.